Hi there, and welcome to another episode of World Beyond Belief. My name's Paul Marco, and I'll be here with you the entire time. Today, we're going to talk about the fascinating topic of the voting ritual. Now, David Icke once said that voting in a national election is like rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic. That's as significant as he thinks it is. And I agree with him. There was a member of parliament named Ken Livingston that once said, if voting would change anything, they would abolish it. And I really believe that. Nobody is going to get into a position of power with the ruling elites around if they're not pre-selected by the ruling elites, they're not pre-briefed by the ruling elites, and probably pre-mind-controlled by the ruling elites. I also don't think that voting in a national election is as innocent as rearranging deck chairs. I think it's a lot more heavy, and I think we should be really careful before we participate in the voting ritual. Let me tell you what I mean. Well, let's start off by wrapping our sane and sensible and maybe logical minds around the twisted and perverted ideas brewed up by our secret society overlords. We have to go there to understand how the game's played from their perspective. And I call it a game for many reasons. One of the main reasons is because of one of their most dominant symbols, which is, funny enough, the game board. This ostensibly symbolizes the black and white, the evil and the enlightened. And I've spoken before about how they're going to use the black and white to entrap opponents, driving them from the darkness to the light. But for today, let's just see it as a game board, one on which we're playing, whether willingly or unwillingly, whether wittingly or unwittingly. And we're playing for our freedom, our sanity, and the continuation of humanity in general. Now, to adequately know how to play our part, we've got to know the answer to some really important questions. We need to know how they see the game being played, what they see as rules, and why do we need rules? We also need to get clear on who the sides are. Now, if you're part of the awakening, you know it's them against us, evil against humanity, the 1% against the 99%. Since they use rituals, why are they important? And why should they be important to us? And how can we strategize around their game plan and win? We also need to know what the guiding principles are that everyone, them and us, are bound by, and how we can use those principles to our advantage. So let's get into that right now. Let's take a look at a concept known as natural law. Now, let's take a minute and get a good understanding of what natural law might be from the expert, Mark Passio.
The word right is synonymous with correct because they are based in truth. Right means both moral and correct because it's based in truth and natural law. If something is correct, it's based in truth. If something is moral, it's based in natural law, and it's based in truth, and it's correct. It's right. Actions that are based in right do not result in harm to other sentient beings. Wrong, contrasted with right, is incorrect. It is immoral. That's why we use it for both meaning both incorrect, you're wrong about that, you gave the wrong answer, and immoral. We follow what is not true. It leads us to immoral behavior. Incorrect, not based in truth. Immoral, not based in natural law. That's what wrong is. And the reason that it's wrong is because actions that are based in it result in harm to other sentient beings. And that's common sense. You know when suffering is being caused to another person. And if there's no suffering being caused to another living being that has provable cause, provable result of harm that has been done to them, then there's no wrong action that has been done, and someone has a right to take that action. You know, someone brought up the other day that, okay, the Islamic law that prevents women from showing their face. Could that be in harmony with natural law? Absolutely not. It's an impossibility for that to be in harmony with natural law. Is it a right or not for a woman to show her face to someone else in public? Of course it is a right. Why is that a universal right? It doesn't matter what a religion says about it. It doesn't matter what a government says about it. It doesn't matter what any individual says about it. At all times, all places in the universe, you are allowed to bare your face in public. Why is it a right? Because you're not harming someone else as a result of that behavior. So let's look at smoking marijuana for an example. Is that a right or is it not a right? It is universally, 100%, unequivocally, at all times and places in the entire universe, a right. Why? Well, one, because you're doing it to you. Shoving a joint in someone else's mouth, lighting it, and forcing them, you know, holding your fingers over their nose and your hand over their mouth until they're forced to take a breath is not a right, because you're doing it to someone else that may not want that. So you're coercing their will, their free will. Whenever there's coercion of free will involved, it's not a right. Because harm is being done. The person is saying no, and you're refusing to accept their refusal. The word no, which we need to start falling in love with. And understand apophysis, which I'm going to touch on at the end here today. But this is the difference between right and wrong. You're allowed to smoke marijuana under natural law because you're doing it to you. You are taking something into your body. That's your property. You own this vehicle while your consciousness inhabits it in this realm. Someone else doesn't own your body. Therefore, they're not allowed to tell you what you're allowed to do with your body via putting something into it. It doesn't matter what justifications or reasons they come up with. Now, that means you're responsible for what you do with your body after you ingest something. You're not absolved of personal responsibility. If you want to take some substance and then do something that is then subsequently do something that is immoral, you need to be held accountable for the action. It doesn't matter that you took something. You made the decision to take something that affected your judgment. And then you did the action, so you're accountable for it under natural law. So understand what natural law is. A living being must be harmed or defrauded in order for a violation of natural law rights to have taken place. And rights that do not exist for an individual can never be granted by man's law to any other individual or any group of individuals. You can't make up a right that other people don't have and say, well, now this group of people has that right. And this is what we think we can do with government and police and militaries, etc., and all kinds of bureaucratic institutions, rights that other people do not have. And they'll claim this nonsensical, non-existent social contract bunk as a result, to justify their immoral behaviors. And there is no such thing. Doesn't exist. There is no such thing as a social contract. There's individuals either choosing to live in harmony with natural law with each other or refusing to live in harmony with natural law. And they're therefore creating chaos instead of order. So we need to know what right is versus what wrong action is. And the best way to know what right is through the negative. And I keep emphasizing this over and over again. Stop accepting this new age bunk of never look at the negative or don't try to define things in the negative sense. That's the best way to define what a right is to take a look, a good, hardcore look, and an honest appraisal of what is wrong. What is a wrong is what you need to truly understand to understand what a right is. Because a right is anything which remains if there is no wrongdoing, which is a harm to another person through your action. So if I sit here and drink a beer, that would have been illegal in 1920, even though I was harming no one. And now suddenly, magically today, that's legal. They can make something from immoral to moral or from moral to immoral at the stroke of a pen. Yeah, you didn't know that's how it works? Morality and immorality have nothing to do with nature's laws. It has to do with the whims of a dictator who writes something down in a little book. and now says, well, that's now immoral. Anybody that I catch doing it is can be punished by whatever dictates I happen to also pen down that they will be punished according to. It was moral to drink a beer in 1920 after prohibition was passed, just like it is moral to do it now. Why? Because I'm putting it into my body. Do I have a right to hold someone down who says that they don't want to drink any alcohol and pour a beer down their throat? No, I do not, and never will, because that's someone else's vehicle for expression, not mine. It's all about ownership and the understanding of self-ownership.
Hey, well, that was Mark Passio, and I'd love to hear him do that. By the way, if you're interested in natural law, go to his site, and we'll have it linked up below, and you can get really deeply involved in natural law. Natural law applies to everybody on the earth, and the elites are no exception, although they think they are and they try to be. That's what the bulk of this podcast is going to be about. It's going to be about looking at how they operate. Now, one thing that they do that was mentioned in this video is they make social contracts, which come up in the forms of treaties, laws, and these things that kind of twist natural law and make certain things legal that really wouldn't be legal. They try to escape natural law. They try to skirt it by these contracts with you and get you in trouble and get you responsible. We'll see how that works over and over again. Since they've done so much of this rewriting and so much of these laws, we've forgotten what natural law is. And it looks like they've exempted themselves from natural law, which isn't the case at all. One thing that we all know about the ruling elites, or the predatory satanic elites, however you want to refer to them, is the fact that they have a tendency to give us forewarning. For example, when they wrote Codex Alimentarius maybe 40, 50 years ago and put it out there, it was their rules to limit good food for us. And although it's slowly being rolled out through the work of people like Rima Labau, it was really cut back. Agenda 21, that's been in the works for a long, long time. They're telling us that they want to move us off the land. They want to restrict the water. They want to house us in small compounds. They told us this up front. Also, we heard that the U.S. wanted to invade 7 countries in 5 years. And we heard it through Wesley Clark, who's a Freemason and a member of the Big Club. So they tell us what they're going to do before they're going to do it. Jade Helm was another thing. We heard about Jade Helm long before it even started, and we don't know what became of it. They also do a really good job of telling us up front by way of the media. Thank you. It's amazing, right? And there's plenty more where that came from. They have a tendency to put everything they're going to do up front. Tell us about it. Now, why do you think they do this? Thinking about it for a while, I came up with like three reasons. One might be that they're nice guys and they want to let us know before they do what they're going to do. Well, I've been watching this satanic pedophilic predator group for a long time. And one thing I'd never say about them is that they're nice guys. So let's scratch that one. The next one might be that they're toying with us, that they feel like play a little bit, give them a hint and do this. And then I don't think they do that. I don't think they want to play with us. I think they want to get the work done. I mean, they would have taken the guns away from the Americans if they could have. They'd have us all microchipped if they could have. But they don't. They're not playing with us. Toying with us is not part of their program. I think it has to do with natural law and their culpability for their actions. I think they're trying to escape culpability, which is their blameworthiness for their action, by giving us some advanced warning. And if they're trying to escape culpability, that means in this whole game, there must be rules. Natural law is one of those rules. And if there's rules, and they're obeying the rules, then that means that they feel, and we may not feel it, but they feel there's an arbitrator. In other words, they're going to be responsible for what they've done in terms of natural law. And if they can escape some of the culpability of it by doing something like, hey, yeah, we did poison them with chemtrails, but we've been telling them that we're doing this for years. Yeah, we did knock down the Twin Towers to start all these subsequent wars, but we told them we were going to knock it down. See how it works? I think they think erroneously, but they think that they're going to escape some culpability by letting us know in the forefront. Now, if they believe that there's an arbitrator and they want to escape culpability, then this sheds a whole bunch of new light on a lot of other things they do. Okay, so one of the things we know that they do is I think they're trying to escape culpability by telling us up front. There's another thing. There's another way they get around their culpability. They make social contracts with us. In other words, we get into deals with them where they do things to us. And these deals are their treaties, their agreements, their laws of the land. They're mostly run by governments. And what they do is they make a contract. In other words, you're agreeing to your own enslavement by agreeing to taxes. You agree to laws. In religion, Mark Passio was saying, the Muslim women agree that they should have their face covered. It's an agreement. It's a social contract between them and their religion. So you see how it works? What they do is they get you to agree to do something that's against natural law. If you're a soldier, they get you to agree to kill someone. That's your agreement with them. So they escape a lot of the culpability by these agreements, by getting you to agree that, yeah, if you want to live in the United States, we have to pay property taxes. If you want to be here, then you have to do certain things. Now, there may be a violation of natural law, but they're not going to be culpable for that. You're going to be culpable because you agreed. You see how it works? So all along, they're getting you to violate natural law that takes away from their culpability and moves them toward where they want to be. See how it works? Now, another thing they do to escape culpability is by delegating the culpability to you. And they do this in a whole bunch of different ways. They'll put you into the military, and they'll delegate killing someone to you. In other words, they're Barack Obama, he said in one of his speeches that he never even handled a handgun. Well, but he's delegating to you, delegating to the people, the culpability of killing people. See, that's how they figure it. They figure that, well, I'm not killing anybody. George Soros never overthrew somebody's government. George Soros wasn't a sniper shooting from the rooftops. No. He delegated that, and when they delegate that, see, it eliminates their culpability. They follow things like the Talmud. Now, in the Talmud, it teaches you that if you want to kill your neighbor, what you do is you grab your neighbor and you tie him up, and he starves to death. That way, you're not culpable for killing him. He died of natural causes. He died of starving to death. See how twisted their logic is? See how this fits together with their action? They make you culpable for what they want to do. They persuade you. They do social contracts. So they have you violating natural law. Why do they think they call the police state a police state? They don't call it a politician state. The politicians, the people that should be culpable for all this, aren't, because they've delegated to you. See how it works? Okay, from these examples, we get a little bit of information about how their mind works, and that this whole thing is to avoid culpability. Now let's move along to elections. Here we have an election where they presented you with candidates. Now, there's no national election where the candidate's not going to be controlled, especially now since they're putting the lid on the New World Order now. So nobody is going to run for an office. And I repeat, nobody is going to be allowed to run for an office or get the endorsement of a major party or be able to win at all unless they're totally controlled. And I suggest mind controlled, because all the candidates that I see now are totally controlled by the system. In the American elections, in the UK elections, it's exactly the same way. I'm sure it's the same way in Australia and throughout the world. Anywhere where the Rothschild Rockefeller Empire runs the country, they're totally controlled. So you're not going to get a choice to vote for somebody that's going to be for the people or for. No, you're going to get a choice between maybe a black, maybe a woman, maybe a guy that calls himself a socialist, maybe a guy that was a rich entrepreneur. You'll get these choices, but they all have got to be controlled. You're not going to get it. Well, look at Barack Obama. Look at all the promises he made. Look at what he was before he was elected, and then look at what he did after he was elected. I mean, you're going to get a choice between evil or evil or maybe evil. Those are going to be your choices. And so when you go into the booth and you make that choice, I believe they do the process to get some of the culpability back to you again. In other words, you picked her. You picked Hillary. She's in office. You picked Obama. He's in office. And everything he does, you're at least partially culpable for, because you backed him. So this is one of the reasons why I think that an election is anything but innocently rearranging deck chairs. I think it puts you back into the culpability to natural law for selecting and putting one of these criminals in office. But that's not the only reason. Let's look at rituals. Yes, they love to do rituals. If you've been watching the satanic elite for as long time as I have, you know that they love to do their rituals. It's really important to them because this is how they get their power. Now, these people are trying to escape culpability for their actions. Meanwhile, they worship these dark forces and they gain their power. And they gain their power through rituals. A prime example is the Bohemian Grove ritual. This is an old ancient Canaanite ceremony called cremation of care. And this is where, for thousands of years, the elites, the members of these secret societies, have sacrificed children to ensure their continued financial success. And you don't have to investigate very far to find that the royal family is involved in pedophilia and these ritual sacrifices. Now, what they want to do with these ritual sacrifices is to get you involved, because if you're watching them or you're involved with them at all, they're getting energy from you into their rituals. For example, let's look at the Super Bowl ritual. Yeah, they love their rituals. And this one, they like you to be involved. They like you to be watching and participating. This one, unfortunately, I was involved with because I was watching it too. I was very ashamed of myself, but I watched this ritual. And this is, they gain power from this ritual. This is a source of power for these people. And you being complicit in it by watching it, it's how they gain their power. Let's move along to another one. Now here we have an example of the ritual that they performed at the 2015 Rugby World Cup. Here's the Antichrist that comes down in the form of a football, and it breaks up the earth, and the Nephilim come alive, infiltrate the whole stadium. They start to come out. It's an incredible ritual, but there's no mistaking it being a satanic ritual. And if you watch this, you were involved. There was another big ritual at the Olympics. There's always a ritual at the MTV Awards. And the reason they show it on TV and the reason is because they want you involved. They want you to be part of this ritual. I think it's part of culpability, but it also, it gives them a lot of strength, because your compliance, your involvement is how they grow strong. They love their rituals. Figure 7 came from IlluminatiWatch.com, and it shows the 8 major sacrificial Illuminati ritual sacrificial dates. You've got, of course, the solstices and then the equinoxes. And then you've got, that's not enough. They have the dates in between. And if you look, it starts with the winter solstice, December 21st. Then you go to February 1st. You'll notice that they do sacrifices 8 times a year. And some of these aren't on what you'd call the traditional equinox or solstice dates. An interesting one is January 20th. You'll notice that there are some days that land on non-established holiday dates. The non-holidays that are part of the sacrifice nights, oddly enough, include the U.S. presidential inauguration day on January 20th. The president's inauguration day used to be set at March 4th until the 20th Amendment was passed, which changed it to this date. Was this date changed on purpose to coincide with the occult night of sacrifice? I would suggest that it was. The purpose, the stated purpose for pushing the date up, was so that there was less time between the day of the vote and the day the president actually takes office. It makes sense. But the fact that this is on a major sacrificial night makes more sense, because they power everything with sacrifices. December 21st, you can really get into this. There's plenty of information on the web as to when they perform these sacrifices. And these sacrifices, during these sacrifices, they love to sacrifice children. They use the code word virgins, but it's any children. If you've looked into the Hampstead cover-up case, or you followed David Icke, or even Pinecone Utopia's coverage of ritual sacrifices, you realize that there's a lot of people involved in these sacrifices, because they need, especially now, they need extra power for what they're doing. Now, you might have noticed that the election day in the United States is always the first Tuesday of November. That can fall anywhere from November 2nd to November 8th. In 2016, it just happens to be on November 8th. And this seems to be located very close to Halloween, which is the major satanic ritual sacrifice of children in all the year. They say that there's a massive amount of children that are sacrificed between March 21st and May 1st. But I think in terms of concentrated effort for ritual sacrifice, I think the Halloween, the 3 days of Halloween, really play into that. And I believe that these sacrifices power the ritual that you go through when you line up and you vote. You turn over your endorsement. You transfer the culpability for what these criminals are going to do to yourself by endorsing them through a vote. Now, these Illuminati, satanic, pedophilic elites, their rituals and their religion and their secret societies go way back to Canaan, Babylon. And this is a really important time in civilizations that have grown out of those ancient civilizations. The ancient Celtic civilization and the ancient Egyptian civilization all work on this Halloween that they call Hallowmas, which is a type of ritual that lasts for many days, up to and maybe including November 5th. And it traces the activities of Isia, which is now Isis, and her search for the body parts of Osiris. If you can remember in that ancient tale, Osiris is dismembered and left for dead. And she spends this week, Isis spends this week reassembling his body parts so he can start anew in the beginning of November, like November 5th or perhaps November 8th, where he starts anew. It's a new cycle. Incidentally, this cycle in 2016 has something to do with women and older women. So I don't know how that's going to affect the election, but we'll have to wait and see. So here's what I think. So now you can see why I think that the voting is not just rearranging deck chairs on the Titanic. It could mean a whole big, important amount of culpability being put back on the public. So, in summary, I guess, be careful of your contracts. Be careful of what laws you obey. Because obeying a law, obedience, doesn't relieve you of culpability in terms of natural law. And the Illuminati and the Satanists are all worried about culpability in terms of natural law. I think you should be too. If you wear a uniform, remember that if you're ordered to do something, it doesn't take away your culpability, because that's how they get the culpability from their back, by giving you an order. So if you're not going to behave in a moral way, even though you're following orders, it's not an excuse. Also, I don't think I'd participate in government rituals at all. I think we know that one of the ways to bring down the matrix and escape the matrix is to not participate in the matrix. We all try not to pay taxes, don't participate in their electronic barrage that we've got with this electronic device and this smartphone and this. Try to pull yourself away from that. Try to get into natural food and a more natural way of living. One of the things that you can do right now is get out of that this voting ritual. Don't think that they're going to have a candidate that you can pick that's going to help you. I don't care what they say. I don't care what the alternative media says. They're not going to allow somebody to assume an office, especially a high office. Now, let me tell you, if you are voting for someone to go onto a school board, and you know that person, and you don't mind being responsible for what that person does, by all means, vote them into office and support it. Or if you're going to go into office yourself, and you're going to be responsible for what you're going to do, but don't vote for somebody in a big national election, or an election that you know they must control, because you're going to be assuming culpability for the actions of that person in the eyes of the satanic elite, who think that's the way it's going to be viewed in the eyes of the arbitrator. I think that if they think there's going to be an arbitrator, you should think there's going to be an arbitrator. And I think you should always keep your activities in line with natural law. In natural law, you're certainly allowed to defend yourself using force against their violations. And you certainly can use the most powerful word in the English dictionary, and that's no. And I think the first thing you need to do is pull your mind out of this election. Don't watch the coverage. Don't watch what's going on. Do not be involved. Pull yourself away. Do not participate in this ritual, because it's a way that they're going to put culpability for their action. And their actions are always charged up by the sacrificial killing of children. So it's a powerful action. Don't be involved. So that's my viewpoint on the voting ritual, and I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.